Hello, everyone. This is Roger Marsh for Family Talk, and I have some exciting news to share. A generous donor has made a $200,000 matching grant to help carry us into the summer. That means that any gift we receive between now and May 31st will be matched dollar for dollar up to $200,000, thanks to this generous matching grant. Dr. Dobson has been fighting for the family for over 40 years, and he's not about to stop now. You can make your donation securely online when you visit drjamesdobson.org. If you prefer, you can find out how to pledge your support by phone when you call 877-732-6825. Won't you please consider joining us in equipping twice as many families with your tax-deductible donation? Again, the toll-free number to call is 877-732-6825. Thank you for your prayers and your financial support of the ministry of Dr. James Dobson's Family Talk.
Today on Family Talk.
Hello, everyone. I'm Roger Marsh, and you are listening to Dr. James Dobson's Family Talk. On today's program, we are excited to bring you the second installment of an interview Dr. Dobson conducted with his good friend Dr. Richard Furman, discussing the topic of fighting Alzheimer's and other forms of dementia. Dr. Richard Furman is a cardiac and thoracic surgeon with 30 years of medical experience. He's the author of 5 books, including Prescription for Life and Your Cholesterol Matters. Dr. Furman also helped found the World Medical Mission, which is the medical response arm of Samaritan's Purse, Franklin Graham's humanitarian organization. On today's broadcast, Dr. Furman will continue to talk about his new book, Defeating Dementia, as he shares with Dr. Dobson the early signs and stages of Alzheimer's and why it is so important for us to take care of the bodies that God has blessed us with. Okay, let's dive in right now to part 2 of this conversation on today's edition of Dr. James Dobson's Family Talk.
Dr. Furman, I find your latest book, Defeating Dementia, What You Can Do to Prevent Alzheimer's and Other Forms of Dementia, to be one of the most interesting books that's come along in a long time. If our listeners are interested at all in general health and especially avoiding the tragedy of dementia of any form, why would we not want to know how to do that? But the point you were making yesterday is this is a disease that you can affect dramatically, and even gave percentages from recent research that proves that. Repeat that for those that didn't hear the program yesterday.
Well, there's a lot that we can be doing to defeat, slow, stop Alzheimer's. But the numbers that I like to think about is that if you're in the 55 to 60 year old range, a third of the people in that age group have that Alzheimer protein in their brain without any symptoms. If you are 65 years old, 10 to 20% of Americans are going to have the symptoms of Alzheimer's.
Name it. That's beta?
Beta amyloid.
Amyloid.
Beta amyloid is in your brain. And that's the first stage, is that first 20 years without symptoms. In that first stage, you don't know you have it. You don't know you're getting it. They had to do an autopsy to find out if you had Alzheimer's.
People are not willing to participate in that study, right?
That's right. But then it got where, like when Mrs. Dale was diagnosed as probable Alzheimer's, they were just tests. You'd do mental testing. But when the beta amyloid, there were two proteins that diagnose Alzheimer's. And you may ought to learn those two. One is beta amyloid and the one is tau protein. The beta amyloid kills the cell. The tau protein is like a starfish out on that carries the message from the cell to the next cell. It gets entwined. It gets tangled up. So that's what happens in that first 20 years in stage one. That is happening, and we don't even know that it's happening. But then you go to stage two, and that's where, like with Mrs. Dell.
That is an assumed name?
That's assumed name.
That is an assumed name. It was actually your mother-in-law.
It's my mother-in-law. And that's what the book takes her progressing through Alzheimer's, but then it intertwines it with what's going on mentally. It talks about what we're talking about right now. Here, Mrs. Dell goes into stage two, and she can carry on life fairly independently. She could travel, she go to the store. She sang in the church choir. She had quit singing solos. But things were, she's starting to forget things. I'd go down to visit them, and her husband would say, you know, I'm concerned. I heard her call somebody on the phone the other day, and she had to ask who it was because she'd forgotten who she called until they answered. And they said later she called and told someone, I'll call you back in a little bit. I forgot why I called you. Things like that. And that's stage two, where all of that's going on. And I got there one weekend. He said, you got to take her driver's license away from her. She went out to a friend's house, drove all the way to Milledgeville, Georgia, and back 2 hours, and she wasn't sure how to get back home. So I talked to her. She was adamant. I can drive. I'm not going to quit driving. I'm going to continue like I'm doing. So I called her doctor, said when she comes in for a checkup next week, write a prescription, no driving. We put it on the refrigerator, and at that moment, she went from stage two to stage three because she quit driving, she became dependent on someone. And if we'd done PET scans, if we'd done studies, brain studies, you'd have seen more of this beta amyloid protein building up in her brain. The hippocampus of the brain is the area that dwells with memory. That is the difference between stage two and stage three.
It's a big jump.
It's a huge jump. You become dependent. You go from there to where, okay, now you're not taking care of yourself. You have to finally you get a walker and then a wheelchair. And then you become bedridden. Nobody understands bedridden until they see someone that they love being put in bed and you realize, hey, life's over. You know, you're not taking them out to a restaurant anymore. You have to put them in the living room because otherwise they're just going to be in the bedroom all the time. They're living in that bed for the rest of their lives. So that's stage three, and it's just a terrible stage. And that's when you realize, what can I do to help my odds of never getting Alzheimer's?
Not a lot you can do to help the person who's in stage three.
You can slow it down. They've got studies showing, doing the PET scans and the MRIs of the brain, if they do the exercise, if they eat properly, if they lose weight. Usually by the time they're at that age, they've already lost the weight and all of that. But the studies show that they go back to midlife and see, were they overweight midlife? Were they obese in midlife? Did they exercise at midlife? What did they eat at midlife? And that shows on through there, that stage two is the big stage when you first start having symptoms. There are a lot of studies done on that, measuring the PET scans to see how much of this beta amyloid is clogging the brain, the hippocampus of the brain, that these are preventable steps that can be made to make that beta amyloid not to form. And the Alzheimer's Association says half of Alzheimer's is preventable. And there was an article in Lancet, a medical journal, that said 87% of everyone with Alzheimer's has at least one preventable factor that they can work on, with whether it's the exercise, weight loss, or how they eat. So there are many things we can be doing that will, even in stage two, will slow that down by these studies, these brain studies showing, okay, all of a sudden you realize that I need to exercise, or I can't eat that way anymore. I'm going to lose weight. It shows that beta amyloid decrease in the deposit in that hippocampus.
You know, there's a spiritual dimension to this too, because we are the temple of the Lord. He lives within us. 1 Corinthians 6:19-20 says, do you not know your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit, who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own. You were bought at a price. Therefore, honor God with your bodies. That's rather dramatic, isn't it? Right to the point.
That's great, and that's what it's all about. That's the way we say thank you for what he's given us. Example, when I went to Nepal, earthquake, after had the earthquake over there, the church there looked brand new. And the reason is they had made it earthquake proof, and the pastor told them, this is not your building. This is God's building. You're the caretaker. The same way with this. God's given us a great body. We're the caretakers of it. And we need to do everything we can to thank him for what he's given us.
What do people say to you when you talk like this? Do you have any idea what percentage of them say, I get it, I will do it?
There are two types of people. One, they would desire it, like I said, or they'll desire it, but they won't make the commitment because of the desire doesn't require action. But if they commit to it, I encourage them to make that a goal in their life, and that they need to sit down and write down every meal you're going to eat, breakfast, lunch, dinner, write it down, just the basics of it, and set that as your goal. It gets where something that used to be favorite will get where once you read and study what it's doing.
I never quite got to that stage.
Well, I blame it on IQ, but we won't go with that. But there are some people that will read something like this and realize, hey, I'm at that fork in the road. I better change my life right now. And that's what I'm wanting this book to become, something other than your heart attack to make you change. And there are things that you can do, paper after paper, showing about things you can do to decrease your chances of that beta amyloid piling up in your brain.
Well, let's kind of review a little bit one of your previous programs, a couple of them, I think, that we did in regard to how that diet really needs to change. And you put the primary emphasis on saturated fat. There are other things, obviously, that you can do, and nutrition is a complicated subject. But you listed 10 things you must not eat. And one of your books started with number 1, 2, and 3.
Yes.
You want to kind of summarize that for folks?
Yes.
Now, what we're really doing is that we've done two programs where we've talked about nutrition as being one of the ways that you can help to reduce the danger of Alzheimer's or other forms of dementia. Let's focus primarily then on food and tell me what that really means.
All right. That's very good, because like Mrs. Dale, she wouldn't have known what saturated fat even meant to her in her days. But let me give you a number to remember on the significance of what we're getting ready to discuss about where does that saturated fat lead you. There's a study that showed that the group, you want to be in the right group, the group that ate the least amount of saturated fat, which is your red meat, this what we're getting ready to go over, versus the 10% that ate the least amount, the ones that ate the most had a, and this is what I like, they didn't say double your chances or whatever, they said 2.2 times more likely to get Alzheimer's. Now just remember that it's not twice as likely, it's 2.2 times. That's how exact they were on measuring this saturated fat that we're getting ready to mention. In the bad picture, I'm gonna give you a little good picture in a minute where this is leading us. But I wanna talk about the good fat, the fish. You should eat, most reports say, eat 3 to 5 fish a week if you can, which would help defeating Alzheimer's. But the study that stands out in my mind was a study that compared someone who ate one helping of fish a week versus a group that did not eat fish. And the ones that ate the one fish a week had a 60% less likelihood of developing Alzheimer's.
That's phenomenal.
There's two pictures that I hope you walk away with. That saturated fat picture, the 2.2 picture, picture a steak. On top of that steak is an egg with a egg yolk humped up. On top of that, they put a piece of cheese, and it breaks the yolk, and the yolk runs down over the steak. You got that picture. Up in the right-hand corner is a glass of milk, which stands for cream. That's ice cream, cream-based soup, any kind of cream. That's 4% butterfat in that milk. That's equivalent to 5 strips of bacon if you're looking at the fat.
Dr. Furman, after I had my heart attack all those years ago, 28 years ago, I thought that I had to eliminate all fat. And that's what I was told at the hospital because they didn't know then.
Right.
And they said, get all fat out of your diet. And I tried to do it. And I was eating about anywhere from 2 grams to 5 or 6 grams per day. Mm-hmm. And yeah, that's hard to do.
Yeah.
I would go to the grocery store and I'd spend 2 hours reading labels and I would walk up and down, you know, trying to cut all that fat out. My cardiologist sent me to a lipid expert, a physician, Dr. Eckel, Robert Eckel is his name. Mm-hmm. And I went to see him, he's in Denver. And I described to him what my diet was. He said, well, I'm going to make some changes. I'm going to put a lot of fat back into your life. And I'm going to put 80 grams of fat into your diet, but it is not going to be saturated fat. I want you to eliminate every bit of that.
Right.
That's great. And then we'll put polyunsaturated and monounsaturated fat in. And that freed me to eat a lot of things that I had not been eating.
Yeah, and most people will put all fats together, but there are bad fats and there are good fats. The other bad was the butter and anything fried. Most things are fried in animal fat, so just get grilled, not fried. But anyway, that's the bad picture. But what you were just saying, what your doctor put you on, was the good fats. You don't eliminate the bad fats and then substitute sugar. You eliminate the bad fats and then substitute the good fats. Eliminate the steak. Start eating the fish. Just a quick little picture of the good fats. Think of a fish. Salmon is the best. But think of fish. You look in the fish eye, its right eye. That's not an eyeball in there. It's a nut. Okay, the nut. Nuts have the good fats in it. You look in the other eye, that's not an eyeball either. You look at that, it's an olive. So you use olive oil for your cooking. You open the mouth, and there's avocado sitting there. Okay, but anyway, won't get into that detail, but that's the good fats versus the bad fats. You want to eliminate. For Alzheimer's, don't eat any of that bad picture. Just go with the good picture.
And research shows that that makes a difference.
It sure does. Just those two examples that we did about the saturated fat 2.2 and then 60% less just with the fish. But the same way with the cholesterol. The higher the LDL cholesterol in your blood.
That's the bad stuff.
That's the bad. That's the lethal cholesterol. The higher that is when you get your cholesterol numbers back, the higher that LDL, that lethal LDL cholesterol is. They've done the studies that show there's more of the beta amyloid protein in your hippocampus, in your brain.
Yeah, there's controversy over this. It's frustrating to me to hear
a lot of
physicians saying, well, that was yesterday. We don't believe that anymore. And they're actually recommending that people eat more saturated fat. Where are they getting that?
A friend of mine argued that butter was the best thing he could eat. But what you have to do is, I like the reality. Okay, if the saturated fat you eat, medically speaking, anatomically speaking, increases the LDL level of the cholesterol in your blood. Saturated fat, the more LDL cholesterol. It's fact. Another fact is the more LDL cholesterol, the worse your arteries are going to be. More heart attacks and more strokes. That's medically proven. What I point is look at the one medicine, the biggest sale medicine in the U.S. It's a cholesterol-lowering drug that lowers your LDL. So from a medical standpoint, why in the world would that be the number one selling drug?
If it didn't do anything.
If it is not doing anything. The FDA is going to, if it's not doing it, they're going to change things. But so I'd have to go by the FDA and the medical literature showing that, yes, the higher your LDL and the lower your HDL, the more of the beta amyloid in your brain. And they've got a study on that. So any discussion, any argument, whatever, let's go to that study that they show that the higher your LDL cholesterol is in your blood, the more beta amyloid you have in your brain, but your test on your test scores are lower.
You know, my cardiologist and I had a conversation about this the other day, and he said, we really do not lose very many people to heart attacks today. You know, it used to be just very common, and mm-hmm. I told you about my family, and what they ate is disgusting to me. My right. grandmother used to fry bacon first and then put the bacon grease in the gravy and in the biscuits. Mm-hmm. Bacon grease, mind you. Yeah. And all of them died. They died early from coronary artery disease. Yeah. So there must be something to it. We made changes, and those medications now have also had an effect, and fewer people are dying of heart attacks. Is that, can you validate that?
Okay, what I'll validate is there's still over half of Americans will die from a heart attack or a stroke from disease of their arteries.
Eventually.
But the one point you said just a minute ago, they died earlier. Yeah. Back then,
yeah.
when they were eating like that. Now we're living a little longer, but that's still the highest death rate, even over cancer or whatever.
There's a lot of work to be done yet.
It's still the same work that we got to work on, but if we're talking about Alzheimer's, remember that those cholesterol numbers directly affect the amount of beta amyloid that's in the brain.
Well, we're almost out of time. I want to kind of summarize what we've talked about. The name of the book is Defeating Dementia, What You Can Do to Prevent Alzheimer's and Other Forms of Dementia by Dr. Richard Furman, who is a cardiologist, a physician, and a surgeon. And this book is a must read because most people know, I don't know they live by it, but they know that saturated fat is dangerous for the heart and so on. And they know that heart attacks are still related to nutrition. They don't know, for the most part, that nutrition is related to Alzheimer's. This is new territory. And the exciting thing is that you can dramatically lower the incidence or the danger from mm-hmm. Alzheimer's by avoiding the things that help to cause it.
Exactly. Yeah. These are just studies that show what you can do to get in the right group of people that has less Alzheimer's than the group that has more. So we want to get in the right group by reading and by doing.
Before we go, we really ought to talk about how people can get this book, because I want to make sure it's available. And of course, you can get it from Amazon and many other places. You can also get it from your website, which is
richardfurman.com.
So this is not something you studied in medical school.
Oh, no.
This is something that's come along recently.
Yeah. All of this is going to be known, I think, by everybody several years down the road. But I think this is just the wake-up call. In closing, I just want to remind you that it's never too late to start on the road to better health and defeating dementia.
You've done a great service to many, many people by what you've written here. I hope this book winds up number one on the bestseller list. It ought to be there because it can change lives. And I appreciate you, Dr. Furman. Appreciate your friendship. And you've been here to Family Talk three or four times, maybe four or five now. And as long as you're writing, there's a place for you at that chair.
Well, thanks for having me. Thank you.
I'm Roger Marsh, and you have been listening to Dr. James Dobson and Dr. Richard Furman talk about the ways to prevent and fight Alzheimer's on this edition of Family Talk. Learn more about Dr. Furman's book, Defeating Dementia, when you visit our broadcast page at drjamesdobson.org. You can also learn more about Samaritan's Purse and the World Medical Mission while you're there as well. So go now to drjamesdobson.org and then simply click on the broadcast page. Are you looking for more Christian content to read and fill your mind with throughout the day? Well, while you're on our website, be sure to jump over to our blog page and check out the various entries we have there as well. Our writers cover a diverse range of topics that are impacting the family, like raising and preparing your kids for the real world, the individual challenges mothers and fathers face, the various problems young adults struggle with, such as pornography and identity issues, and how to spend quality time with God. We encourage you to stop by our blog page at drjamesdobson.org and hear from the voices for your family. I'm Roger Marsh. Thanks so much for listening today. Make sure to be with us again next time for another edition of Dr. James Dobson's Family Talk.
Family Talk is not associated with Focus on the Family.